He would go on with the song. At the same moment, I would open the window. Come, lazy bones, he would cry when he saw me. Don't you see the sun? And other times, he would say more simply, Ellie, Ellie, Ella, it is day. Marshawn would have his turn, but less often because the Emperor was less frequently on the side where Marshawn lived. Marshawn, Mademoiselle Marshawn, he would say as he called him, it is day, get up. When Marshawn arrived, he would look at him laughing and say, did you sleep enough last night? Were your slumbers broken? You will be ill all day because you got up so early. Then, taking his usual tone, come, take that pickaxe, that spade, make me a hole to put such and such a tree in. While Marshawn was making the hole, the Emperor would go a little further and seeing a new planted tree, Marshawn, bring a little water here. Water this tree. And a moment afterwards, go and get me my foot rule, my yardstick. To another, as he came up to him, go and tell Archibald to bring me some manure and tell the Chinese to cut some turf. There is no more. Then coming to me, who was holding a shovel to load a wheelbarrow with. What, have you not finished removing that earth? No, sire. And yet, I have not been playing. By the way, rascal, have you finished the chapter which I gave you? But, sire, your majesty only gave it to me last night. Try to finish it today. I have another to give you. When the emperor would pass on to Pierron, who was laying a piece of turf. What, you haven't finished that wall? Have you enough turf to finish with it? Yes, sire. They're coming back to me. What time was it that I waked you last night? 2 o'clock, sire. And a little later he asked me, is Montalon awake? I don't know, sire. Go and see. Above everything, do not wake him. Let him sleep. Then going to Novaraz, who was digging with his pickaxe. Come, work hard. Lazy bones. What have you been doing all morning? Yesterday, your majesty told me to have the bath tarred. As I could not find anyone willing to do it, I did the job myself. Sire, there's Monsieur de Montalon. Good morning, Montalon. Monsieur de Montalon, bowing respectfully. How is your majesty? Fairly well. Did they disturb you? No, sire. I was up when they came to my room. Has your excellency anything to tell me? They say there's a ship in sight. I do not know, sire. I have not seen anybody. Take a telescope and go and see if it is in sight. Monsieur de Montalon came back a few minutes later and told the emperor what he had seen. The emperor would go here and there as he walked, and he would come back to his workers from time to time. In this way, he would await the hour of breakfast. When he felt hungry, he would ask what time it was, and if he was told that it was near 10 o'clock, he would order it served. It was usually served in his bedroom. Then the emperor would leave his workmen and go and sit down at table. Those who were to wait on him would leave their tools, go and wash their faces and hands and go to him. When breakfast was over, the emperor would come back to his workmen and remain till midday or only till 11 o'clock if the sun was too hot. And when he left them, he would say, go and get your breakfasts. It's enough for today. It's too hot. When the emperor had gone back to his room, where he was followed by one of his valets, he would take off his dressing gown or his jacket or his pantaloons and get into bed. If he remained dressed, he would sit down on his sofa or at his desk. If he did not feel like going to sleep when he laid down, he would send for Marshawn for him to read aloud, but he directed him not to come till he had had his breakfast and had dressed. In the other case, he would have the shutters closed and the curtains drawn and would sleep for some hours. Also, it often happened he took a bath some hours after his meal. During the work on his gardens, he almost always had a bath ready. The rest of the day he passed, as I have told elsewhere, the work in the garden had gone on for several months. For a long time, great activity had been shown in them, but little by little, this activity decreased. The emperor himself also sewed up. The result of making the gardens was for the emperor that he kept his people busy, that he amused himself, that he got gardens and walks about his house, where he felt at home, and that he removed the guards to a distance, for previously they had been under his very windows. As for the product, it was nil, except that once in a while he had a little bowl of salad, a little dish of beans or peas, and a bunch of radishes on his table. As for fruit, there were only peaches, and the emperor did not eat them. When the emperor saw something on his table which came from his garden, he would say, after all our trouble has not been wholly lost, our gardens are feeding us. We could not help smiling. What rascal are you smiling about? The emperor would say, looking at one of those who were waiting on him, and he would smile himself. Sometimes the emperor would amuse himself watering the first wall, which the English had built in over as his garden. This wall was less exposed to the sun than that which we had built in the west garden, and had preserved its first freshness. The emperor had bought a pump with a cistern attachment in order to enjoy this pleasure, and it was precisely about 3 o'clock when he had finished dressing that he would think of sprinkling the turf of his wall, that which was around the stone basins. All that he had to do was to hold the nozzle and aim it while one of us pumped. As he never took any care, he never let go the pipe without having his shoes and stockings wet and covered with mud. And it was only when those about him pointed out to him that if he remained in this condition, he might catch cold, that he consented to change his things. Chapter 13, Religion. Some months after Madame de Maupassant's departure, that lady had left the island in July 1819. It had been learned at Longwood that several persons had started from Rome for England, where they were to embark for St. Helena. Word of it had been received, and every day for a month or two, their arrival had been expected. Finally, they landed at Jamestown on September 18th or 19th in the morning and were sent on to Longwood about 6 o'clock in the evening. These men had been sent by the imperial family in response to the request which had been made for them. There were 5 of them, 2 priests, a doctor, a cook, and a servant. The first 3 were Corsicans, the 2 others French. The emperor received the 2 priests and the physician one after the other. He expressed to all of them his surprise that they had not been furnished with some lines of introduction. He attributed the blame for this to the cardinal Fesch, and could not conceive how, in the position in which he, Napoleon, found himself, they should have omitted something which was in his eyes of the greatest importance, and which the members of his family had passed over so easily and lightly. In spite of so great an irregularity, he accepted the newcomers. He talked to them for a long time and entered into the greatest detail.